The Missouri Ozarks is a good place to hole up. The infamous bandit Jesse James hid in its caverns for years. What if plants could do the same? As temperatures rise, could the Ozarks provide them a safe refuge? Find out in this episode of Our World by Degrees. Deep in the heart of America is the Ozarks, a vast expanse of valleys, bluffs, and dense trees that has captivated outlaws and explorers for centuries. But it's what's happening under this thick canopy today that is attracting researchers from around the world to an important Ozark field station known as Tyson Research Center, a 2,000-acre wooded wonderland 20 miles southwest of Washington University in St. Louis.
I had always wanted to work at a field station. I'm also from Missouri, so having studied across the United States, coming back to these ecosystems that are very familiar and that I learned a lot about as a kid, just hanging out in the woods, it was really a familiar place for me when I started here in 2013.
Director Kim Medley knows the landscape like no other.
This is an Ozarks oak hickory forest, and it's quite hilly. And we have north-facing slopes are cooler and wetter than south-facing slopes. We have these steeply sloped valleys. And then as you go downhill, in each of these valleys, we have intermittent streams that flow during typically larger rain events. Things like that can lead to variations in microclimate. You start to dig deeper and deeper in finer and finer scale, the variation is much more intense.
Variations in temperature have scientists wondering if the landscape naturally creates safe havens, known as microrefugia, for plants and animals to outweather the weather as surrounding temps rise.
Microrefugia have become much more of a research interest in the last couple decades because of climate change.
Nearby, the Missouri Botanical Garden is home of one of the world's largest herbaria, or libraries of plants. Here, Adam Smith and his colleagues can trace a plant's history back to its roots and build models to predict its fate.
A lot of times when we run our projections through the future, we find that the models at least say that species will be totally wiped out. And yet when we look at the past where species have been affected already by climate change, we see that in some cases, in some little places, they can hang on. So when I had this assignment to figure out which plants we should be targeting for conservation, I was constructing models of the climate that they like, and sure enough, they like the climate on top of the Ozarks, so to speak, right now. But then I could take those models and project them to the future, to 2050 or 2070. And the first time I did that, that climate moved out of kind of the field of view. And then I thought, wait a second, I zoomed back on the map that I was looking at, and the climate that that plant liked, which is currently in the Ozarks, was up in Canada. And personally, that was like one of two times I've kind of pushed back from my desk in horror. We've always talked about climate change, but in some sense for me, even though I study it intimately, it wasn't personal. And then I realized, like, this is the future that I will be living in. It just really kind of stunned me, and it still does, honestly.
Balancing the cares of the world is not easy for conservation scientists. For many, like Adam, it only motivates them more. With support from the Living Earth Collaborative, a small research team developed 35 microclimate stations using high-tech sensors to collect detailed temperature readings every half hour of every day for more than a year.
What we'd like to do with the microclimate data that we've collected at Tyson is make a map of temperature across the entire region and get detailed temperature measurements at places and in ways that plants would actually experience them. This is useful because it allows us to extrapolate beyond just Tyson Research Center to identify the types of landforms that will create microrefugia, which might allow certain plants and animals to persist even though the larger climate is changing.
This new data will help researchers like biologist Jonathan Myers, who are studying long-term changes in forests and biodiversity.
climate is critical for large numbers of species, and probably one of the environmental variables that's more sort of the proximate causes of their lifestyle and the landscape. And so being able to actually test the degree to which these variables or measures are related to microclimate or perhaps not is really helpful for trying to answer all the questions that we're exploring out here.
Jonathan and his students are part of a network of global researchers in local sites, known as Forest Geo. They have been contributing data about Tyson's forests to better predict future outcomes. New knowledge about microrefugia will help these global scientists grapple with how best to support plants and animals for long-term conservation efforts.
Not only is this project filling a gap in terms of the literature on species distributions, it can contribute to this growing resource of data that can assist other investigators down the road in answering completely new questions.
But the biggest question is for humanity. The choices we make today about reducing greenhouse gas emissions will determine our climate in the future. Human nature can be as elusive as the bandit Jesse James, but one thing we know for sure, the infamous Ozarks, with their cooling curves, limestone bluffs, and hollows, like many mountain ranges, can offer a safe refuge in the promise of hope amidst a changing world.